So this time the topic is text classification, or in particular sentiment classification. So before we begin with this, Jeremy actually discusses about activation functions and universal approximation theorem. So first off, we'll get that out of the way. We'll have a small discussion on that, and then we'll move on to this, the main topic. So I guess most of you must already know about activation functions, and universal approximation theorem was kind of new to me, but it's quite an interesting topic as well. So first off, activation functions, as you all know, is just something that we have in neural network to add non-linearity into the neural network. So just a minute. So as you all know, a neural network just looks something like this, and you have a bunch of layers, hidden layers in between. So, and you have weights for each input, and then a bias is added, and then a bias is added here. So, and that we represent, or we do that calculation using matrix multiplications. So it's just a series of matrix multiplication. Now a matrix multiplication, and then addition of bias. So what that is is just a linear transformation of the input, right? So if you have a bunch of layers, all that does is do linear transformations over and over again on the input, which is just equivalent to one linear transformation. And then the only thing you will be able to do with such a neural network is just learn simple linear mappings between input and output, which is not a very useful neural network, obviously. So this is where activation functions come into picture. The nonlinearity, that is, so basically the output that we get in this hidden layer, we pass it through the activation function, which helps us learn nonlinear mappings between input and output. So as you know, the popular activation functions are sigmoid and tan h and ReLU. So these were used earlier. Right now it's mostly ReLU, which is rectified linear unit. So as Jeremy says, you can simply write it as max of 0, x. So if it's negative, it's just made 0, and the positive value is retained. So it's actually a non-linear function, as you can see. And ReLU actually works fairly well and is used in most of the situations. So that is in brief the you function of activation functions. And so in neural network, we have a sequence of matrix multiplications and non-linearities, where the non-linearities, just a minute. Where the non-linearities are of any of the activation functions that I just mentioned. So now we'll get into what universal approximation theorem is. So with this implies a sequence of matrix multiplication and non-linearities. So with this combination, what this theorem says is that you can approximate any function arbitrarily close, given that you have enough nodes. So the only thing that you have to do is find the particular values of the weight matrices in your matrix multiplication that solve the problem that you want to solve. That is, the approximate the particular function at hand. And this weight modification, we obviously do by backpropagation and gradient descent. So this is what universal approximation theorem is. Any complex function any complex function that maps the input to the output can be learned by a neural network, given that it is complex enough. And Jeremy also points out to this really good resource. Again, I didn't read through the entire thing, but what the gist of it is that suppose you have one input, and that one input is represented by this axis. So you can imagine any complex function on this axis. It can be approximated by just adjusting the weights and biases that we have here. That is what universal approximation theorem is. This is for one input, and you can imagine the same thing when you have a number of inputs. And so you can imagine a really complex function on here, and it can be represented by just many rectangles like this. Any function you can imagine can be just represented by many rectangles like this. And there's even, yeah. So we're adjusting these biases and even the weights. So I don't know, there's really good animations here. Yep. By just adjusting these things, you can adjust these small rectangles. And by having enough number of nodes, you can create as small and as tall tiny rectangles like this as you want. So this is how you can intuitively understand universal approximation theorem. When there's just one independent variable, you can learn any complex function. So the same thing extends and scales to a complex latent space, a complex multidimensional space. So this is basically universal approximation theorem. And this is how neural nets learn complex mappings between inputs and outputs. And I thought this was quite interesting. Anyone of you have any doubts or questions in this or anything to add? Because even I was fairly new to this theorem. I think then we can get into the actual notebook. So this time we are dealing with text classification. So all our helper functions are in this particular module, which is fastai.text. And the data set contains, so this is obviously the IMDb data set. It's quite a popular movie review data set with labels as positive or negative. And text classification in, and the algorithm that we'll be using in this is called ULM fit, which is universal language model fit, I guess. So apparently ULM fit is right now the best model for, achieves the best metric on this particular problem, the IMDb dataset. And text classification in general is a very useful problem. It is used in problems like spam detection or news article genre detection, and even the example with Jeremy shares, which is a legal document classification. So, and ULM fit works really well on text classification problems. And so this particular data set has 25,000 labeled data sets as positive and negative, 25,000 for testing, and there are 50,000 unlabeled data as well. And as you will see, these 50,000 are also, we'll be using it even though it's unlabeled. And so first off, we'll start with a small sample of these IMDb data set, which is in a particular string called IMDb sample. So we'll just download. So this contains the URL where this data set is, and we'll just download from that. So again, I'm using Colab as my storage. So this is an extra additional cell. And then I'm setting the path in my Colab. So this for this IMDb sample data set, there is just a CSV. It looks something like this with the label negative, positive, etc. And so we read it using pandas, pd.read.csv. And then a validation which contains a Boolean value which says whether it is included in the validation set or not. So we just opened one random review. This is how it looks. And a data bunch can be made. So as we know, in FastAI, whatever data set that you have, the first thing that you do before you feed it into a learner model, learner object, is you make it into a data bunch. So for image, you make it an image data bunch. For text, you make a text data bunch, stuff like that. So this is the first thing that you do. And a data bunch can be made using either factory methods or data block API. And as you discussed earlier, factory methods is just a simple way to make it, but you have lesser customizations available. Whereas data block API, you create it step by step. I mean, you mention all the steps and you can add your own custom, you can modify it to any extent you want, adding your own parameters and arguments. So here he is just showing us how to make it using the factory method. Factory method is from CSV, from name RE and stuff like that. This is a quick way to create data bunch from CSV of texts. So for now, we are ignoring the validation rule since we are just seeing how to make it. You just give it the path and the name of the file. So as you know, a machine learning algorithm always needs numerical data. That's how it works. You can't just feed text into it. So image can be fed directly because they are just pixel values, whereas a text text is composed of words. So we can't apply mathematical functions on them directly. We have to convert them to numbers. And the way we do that is tokenization and numericalization. And the text, so while we make the text data bunch from our data set, all of this is done behind the scenes, the tokenization and numericalization. So here Jeremy is just showing you how to make a data bunch in case of text data. We are not going to actually work on this particular data set. So we can save it and load it again. So now we'll see what happens behind the scenes when this creation of data bunch is done. The first step in that is tokenization. So tokenization is just splitting the sentences into the smallest linguistic entity, basically words. So the easy way to do it is just, this is the basic way to do it, is just splitting on spaces. But there are some more complicated stuff that have to be taken care of. For example, didn't would be separated into did and not, or n apostrophe t. Everything is lowercase. So this is what happens in tokenization. And if words that are really rare, they are replaced with xx unc. And anything that starts with xx is just some special token. So there are different types of data bunches depending on the particular task you have at hand. So if you want to create a language model, you don't need the labels. You don't need faults and stuff like that. So there you would just make a text data bunch. So if you want to do a classification, you would need to make a text class data bunch. And then, So if you do a show batch on this type of data bunch, you can see the target as well, negative, positive, and stuff like that. So these are some particular points to be noted that happened in tokenization. Even the HTMLs are cleaned. The HTML tags are cleaned. There are several special tokens to replace unknown tokens or to introduce different text fields. Okay. And then numericalization. So obviously we have to convert it to numbers before we feed it into our neural network. Tokens are then converted to integers by creating a list of all words used. So there would be a vocabulary, which is basically a list of all the words. And then we don't want it to be too large because our neural network will also become, our matrices will also become that big in our neural network, the larger the vocabulary size. So they keep a restriction of size 60,000 and replace the ones that don't. So each word has to appear at least twice. If a word appears just once, those will be removed and they'll be just replaced with unc, the unknown token. And the mapping between IDs to tokens is stored in the vocab attribute of our data bunch in a dictionary called ITOS, which stands for integer to string. So XX unc is index 0, XX bad is index 1, etc. So here I'm just checking the type of each of these objects. So this is our train DS is our it's a fast AI text object, and then 00 is the actual first text in our data set, and 01 denotes its particular category, whether it's positive or negative. And underlying data is all numbers, which is the particular mapping of the word to its particular integer. And then Jeremy just shows how would you do the same thing by using data block API. Here we had used, earlier we had used factory method, and how would you do the same thing using data block API. As you all know, data block API is more, as a more customizable way to make it. It offers a lot more flexibility than what the factory methods offer. In the previous example, the data was randomly split between train and validation. Because I don't think this is something that you can mention if you're just using factory methods. Data block API gives you a way to mention how do you split between train and validation. Split from DF call equal to 2, because the second column is what, as you've seen in the Excel, this the second column or 012, the second column is what gives you the boolean which represents whether it is in the validation set or not. And and the label is in the first column, that is 0. So this is how you would make the same thing using data block API.
Just a quick question, Gautam.
Yep.
When you say factory method, I'm assuming using PyTorch method. Is that correct?
Oh, no, even this is a fast AI method, it's not a PyTorch method. It's just a quick, dirty way of making a data bunch when you don't want to customize it too much. So it's just a fast AI object. It's not a PyTorch object, actually.
Okay.
So I think this data bunch concept is a fast AI concept. So fast AI is just an API on top of PyTorch, right?
Yes. So in a sense, So text class data bunch is you're calling the factory method, which is
No. What we are making is a text class data bunch, and you make a text class data bunch either using factory methods like from CSV or from name RE, or this is a, like I said, a quick and dirty method, or you can make a text class data bunch using a complex data block API where you mention each step one by one. At the end, what you want is a text data bunch. So like I said, it also depends on what your end motive is. If you are doing a classification task, you need a text class data bunch.
Yeah.
If you are making a language model, there you would just need a normal data bunch. So in a normal data bunch, you would not need to specify what is the label, like negative, positive. Because that's a language, that's for a language model.
Yeah, that's correct. Yeah.
So the end motive is to just, we have to make the data bunch. You can either make it using a factory method or using data block API.
Okay. So that's the confusion I have. So what's the name of the factory methods? That's the text data bunch, is it?
No. It's from CSV.
Okay, so and what's the customized method?
This whole thing is the data block API. It's how you can mention each customizations that you want to make separately.
Okay, so all you're saying is like either you specify these variables or these parameters, or you left it for default value, which Jeremy has put it in.
Yeah. And sometimes you won't be able to even specify them if you don't use a data block API.
Right. Okay. So why it's called a text list here, and if you go scroll up, it's called something else. So
actually we are making the same thing. So at the the end, I think if you look at the type of this data, it would still be, it would be a text class data bunch only. It would be a text data bunch. So only after this particular step, it becomes a data bunch object.
Okay.
Whereas in that case, we are directly making the text data bunch.
Oh, I get it.
Without mentioning these important things that we have to do.
Oh, correct. I was missing the last method, the dot data bunch method.
We have to make a data bunch either way. There is no escaping from that, because data bunch is what we will be feeding to the learner model, the learner object.
That's correct. Yeah. Thanks.
So now we'll move on to the actual classification. So when we do NLP classification, we actually create two models. The first model is something called language model. We'll be looking into that. And after we have created the language model, we'll fine tune it to create the classifier. We create the data bunch of the classifier and then create a learner and train it. Okay. So language model. A language model is a model that predicts the next word of a sentence. So you can think of it as you're feeding one word, and then at the end of that neural network, there's a softmax which has output node of all the words in your vocabulary, and then this model is just predicting, giving you, just spitting out the probabilities of each word in your vocabulary, and then that is how you predict the next word. So that is what a language model basically is. It just gives you probability of each word given the history of words. That's what a language model is. And we'll see why it is useful for us. So if you train a neural net to predict the next word of a sentence, then you actually have a lot of information. So if you were to just use this reviews, all you have, if you were to just directly use this into a neural network model, all you have is just one bit, like Jeremy said, you just have 1010 and then a bunch of tokens. So that is, and then 25,000 examples of that, which is actually quite less, not at all enough for a neural network to learn properly. So if you train a neural net to predict the next word of a sentence, then you actually have a lot of information. So rather than having a single bit to every 2000 word movie review, liked it or didn't like it, for every single word, you can try and predict the next word. Yeah. So for each word, you can just predict what the next word is given the history of words. So that actually, so you are having a lot to learn from that. So in a 2000 word movie review, there are 1,999 opportunities to predict the next word. And a really good language model can be made using Wikipedia articles as well. So like Jeremy says, the tough task is to understand how language works or how English is basically written. That is the tough task. And once that is learned, the classification problem becomes easier. So how I understand this is that, so basically you are making a language model, which is a model that learns how English language is written. So given, so like the example which Jeremy gives, I think I have it somewhere here. Probably not. Okay, this is lesson three.
Hey, Gautam. I don't think we can hear you.
Okay, can you hear me now? Hello?
Yeah, you're back.
How long was I out?
Probably a minute.
Okay, sorry.
You were searching for that the one document you were searching there.
Okay. Yeah, I'll just repeat what I was saying. Sorry about that. So I was just talking about the intuition of language model. So language model, as I was saying, is just a model that is really good at understanding how English is written, understanding what the next like giving out probabilities of what the next word is. So basically, so how I have understood like how I have intuitively understood language models is that when you feed words into the language model, it just creates an encoded representation of the word, and then by creating good feature representation of the word, that is how it becomes good at predicting what the next word would be, right? So when you feed a word into the neural network, it creates good feature representation, and using that encoded feature representation, it predicts what the next word in the what the next word in the sentence could be. So the idea is that we can just use those really well-learned feature representation and then use it for our classification task. So this is how I have understood this particular concept of training a language model and then using it for our classification task.
Can you again the part? So we once we learned what the ne next word is, then
Yeah, so a language model is, so the language model is basically a neural network. It's an RNN, right? It's a recurrent neural network, and then at the last layer is a softmax with all the words in your vocabulary. Suppose you have 60,000 words. I think this is correct. If someone thinks I'm wrong, please point me, I mean please point it out. So the last layer, there would be 60,000 nodes, and then there's a softmax, and then it predicts what the next word given your past words is. So in this complex neural network, obviously what happens is there is some kind of encoding that is done of your inputs, right? There is some kind of feature representation that is done of the words that are fed into the neural network. So how you would use this language model? So obviously the language model learns really good encoding of your inputs. So once this language model is well learned, well trained, it learns really good encodings, and then we are just using those encoded representations and then using it for our classification task. And this really brings the point home, like, so in one review there are 1,999 opportunities to predict the next word. So a language model really learns well the encodings of words, and then it is done on the entire Wikipedia articles. So it learns basically well, really well, the encoded how language can be encoded. So now we can just use that and then fit a classifier on top. Instead of just using it to predict the next word, we'll fit a classifier. And that is how I believe this concept of training a language model first and then using it to do classification works. Yeah. Was that confusing? Or anyone have any ideas, please feel free to join. Was that clear for you?
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah.
I think we'll, yeah, just learning how language models, if once we learn how language models work, it will be even more intuitive, I
Correct.
Yeah. Like the pre-trained ImageNet model for vision, there is a pre-trained Wikitext model for NLP. which is a trained language model of all of Wikipedia. So like I said, it's not particularly useful in itself. Predicting the next word of a sentence is somewhat useful, but it is not what we want to do. It is a model that understands a lot about language and a lot about what language describes. Again, then we used to do transfer learning to create a new language model that's specifically good at predicting the next word a movie reviews. So we'll just fine tune this language model to our movie review data set. So it becomes good at, a good language model of movie reviews. So because the words that are used in reviews and the context in which the words are used in reviews might be different from how it's used in Wikipedia. So we would have to do a fine tuning for that. This would be especially more important if you have very domain specific stuff like medical documents and legal documents and stuff. But like Jeremy says, even if you have very domain specific documents, it is always good if you use a pre-trained Wikitext model first and then fine tune it on your documents. And then this particular concept is called self-supervised learning. So in language model, as we have explained, there is no real label as such. We are just each word in itself becomes a label, which is predicted using the previous words. Yeah, so that's why it's called self-supervised learning. And then these models are really GPU intensive. I'm going to decrease batch size here. And this time, we'll be using the entire just a minute. There's a mistake here. This should be IMDb, not IMDb sample. Yeah, I think I changed it at the moment. So this time actually we are using the whole data set, which has 25,000 reviews in training, 25,000 in validation, and 50,000 without labels. And then we download, we untar it using the untar data function, which is a FastA inbuilt function. So these are the folders in that. And then inside train, again, there are folders inside that with negative, positive. The reviews are in training set following an ImageNet structure. And there is an unsupervised and subfolder on top of train and test. So like I said, 50,000 of them are without labels. So even though these are without labels, they are useful because we'll be using them to train our fine-tuned language model. So obviously fine-tuned language model training does not require labels. So that's why we'll be able to use it. So we are not going to train a model that classifies the reviews from scratch. Like in computation, we'll use a model trained on bigger data set. So we'll be training on the subset of Wikipedia called Wikitext 103. The model has been trained to guess what the next word is, its input coming from all the previous words. So a language model is usually some kind of LSTM. It has a recurrent structure and a hidden state that is updated each time it sees a word. The hidden state thus contains some information about the sentence up to that point. So what it says is that it's not just the previous word that is being used. So there is a hidden state that is passed, so which contains information about the sentence up to that point, not just the previous word. We are going to use the knowledge of English language to build our classifier. But first, like for computation vision, we need to fine tune it to the pre-trained model to our particular data set. And like I said, the English isn't that same as that of the English in Wikipedia. So that's why we will have to fine tune our language model to our particular data set. There might be some words that are extremely common in the reviews, but barely present in Wikipedia, and therefore might not be part of the vocabulary the model was trained on. Yeah, so there are small factors like this which make it important that we have to train it on our particular data set as well. Like I said, this is where the unlabeled data is useful. We'll be using it to train our language model. So here we use data block API to create the language model data bunch. So I had already done this once, that's why I commented it out. So we use from folder factory method, and then filter by folder. So here we would use both train, test, and unsupervised. The reason we use test as well is because we are actually creating a language model. We are not making the classifier here. If you are making a classifier and then using the test data set, that is obviously wrong. But it does make sense that you can use it for training your language model. You are not using the labels or anything. You're just making the language model. So it makes sense that you use it as well. And then you will be using the unsub folder as well, which are the unlabeled ones. And we split them by a random percentage because obviously here the train test stuff does not matter since we are just creating the language model. So we will just use a random validation percentage. And then the labels are also different. It's not the positive negative. The label for language model is, like I said, the word. So this word would be the label, and all of this would be our independent variables. Yeah, so that would be done by the model itself. We don't have to do anything. We just have to say label for language model. And we save that particular data bunch. And yeah, we use, like I said, the labels stand specifically for language models. We save that particular language model data bunch, and then we load it again. And then when we show batch, this is how the text looks. It is tokenized, and as you can see, there are no labels. And then we used this, which is the pre-trained model on Wikitext, and then we create our own language model learner. So this is the learner object for learner class for creating language model learner objects. And this is the dropout, which is used for avoiding overfitting. I guess we'll be learning about it later on. And then we do LR find. LR find is to find out the optimal learning rate. So basically a mock training is done for one epoch. And then find out, and then the learning rate is varied between a lower value and higher value, and then we plot how the learning rate drops, and then we find out the learning rate at which the slope is the maximum, which apparently is 1 in 2, and this 1 in 2, and then we do fit one cycle using 1 in 2. So this 1 in 2 becomes the max learning rate of our last layer group. So as you know, in fit one cycle by default, only the last layer group trains. All of the other layer groups are frozen. And then this is, so this becomes the max learning rate. So as you know, in cyclical learning rate, the learning rate varies between a lower value and the max learning rate. This we had discussed in the last lesson as well. This is how it jumps out of local maximas, and then learning rate should be lower as you reach closer to the actual maxima. So that is the concept of cyclical learning rate. If you have doubts regarding this, go back, refer the previous video where we had previous meetup where we had discussed about this. And then momentums, we will be learning about them, I guess, in a future lesson. So I actually had lost training. I mean, I'd lost the last time when I trained, so I had to train them again. So this, and then we unfreeze it, the usual thing. Unfreeze them and fit them for, so after we unfreeze, all the layer groups are up for training, all the layer weights are modified, and then we fit 10 more epochs on top of that. And once that is done, our language model is trained. So this language model, like I said, is good at predicting the next word given a sentence, given the word in a sentence, which we can see by just doing learn.predict and then just feed it a sentence and number of words and sentences, and it gives a fairly coherent output. And it does make bit sense. It is not it's not that foolish or anything. I like this movie because the cool scene, it does make sense. And then we have to save not only the model but also its encoder, the part that's responsible for creating and updating the latent state. For the next part, we don't care about the part that tries to guess the next word. So like I had said before, a language model, once it is trained well, it creates a good encoding of the words that are fed into it. That's how, I mean, once it creates a good feature representation, only then it's able to predict what the next word is. So then we can use that encoder and then use it for our classification. All right. Again, we do the same thing. This time we'll create a data classification data bunch. And then obviously we'd have to use the same vocab as we have in the data language model, since we'll be using the same encoder here. So we'll have to use the same vocab. So this time our folder would be validation. Validation would be test. So this time we should not obviously use the test data, since we are creating the actual classification model this time, and label from folder. So inside train and test, there are further subfolders, negative and positive. So we'll label using those. So actually these are the things that you would not be able to specify if you were just using the direct factory method. Only in data block API, you can do all of these things, I think. And then you create the final data text class data bunch using this method, and then you save it again, and then when you show batch this time, since we created a text class data bunch, you can see the labels as well, which you would not see if you had created just a text data bunch. Now we create a text classifier learner as opposed to a language model learner which we made last time. And then we use AWL STM, and then we load the encoder which we had saved last time around, and that is loaded into this particular learner object. I lost these because I did not have them last time. I'll see if I can get those from Jeremy's notebook. So we do the same thing basically. LR find is to find the optimal learning rate, and then we get it using the we'll have to manually get it from the graph, and then we fit one cycle again for the last learning rate. Okay, it's not here as well. Okay, doesn't make a difference then. So here what we do is, usually in fit one cycle, only the last layer group is trained, and then we unfreeze the whole model, and then all the layer weights are modified. So in this case, what we do is we just unfreeze the last two layer groups. Apparently for text classification, it helps to unfreeze one layer group at a time as opposed to unfreezing the whole neural network. So if we do that, and then we give slice. So slice is because, so slices, so each layer group will get its own max learning rate. That is what slice is. And then we train one more epoch on top of that. We save it, and then we unfreeze, like I said, unfreeze one layer group at a time. Now we move to three, and then give the slice of the max learning rates. And then the same thing is done. And then we unfreeze the whole thing. And then two more epochs of training on top of that. And then we get an accuracy of 94, which is the highest as of when Jeremy was looking at the highest accuracy on the IMDb dataset. Anyone have any doubts or anything? Any questions or anything to discuss? Or if anyone has done any work of their own with regards to text classification or anything to share?
For me, if I could just make a comment.
Hello?
Oh, I'm sorry. Am I talking over somebody?
Can you tell me why the last two players are unfit? Or is it only for this model, trial and error, or for every model, every text model?
What Jeremy says is what I've written here. He just says for text classification, it helps to unfreeze one layer group at a time. So till now, for all the image segmentation, image classification, we have unfrozen the all the layer groups at once. This is what he says. He has not given any proof. It just works empirically to unfreeze one layer group at a time. If you are asking me for an explanation, I don't know.
What I was just going to say was about that as well, was just that what I've noticed with Jeremy is he'll set us up and show us a lot of, this is how we do it, this is what the pieces mean, mm-hmm. You know, let's get comfortable with it. And then usually that last minute or two, he does this magic where he'll do something really insightful that really just says, hey, I was playing with this and it turns out that this worked well.
Yeah, he does that often.
Yeah, and I think what he wants us to do is just get comfortable, and then we try some things to say, oh, that's really interesting, or that's taking a long time, or I don't understand that. And then I can go back and kind of rebuild an intuitive grasp of what's going on. You know, because before he does that unfreezing, he basically has a pretty good classifier, you know, 93% accuracy. And then when he starts playing with the learning rate on every layer, just undoing it one at a time, he's able to go from 93 to 94% accuracy. So he was able to kind of play with it at the end and show us that, hey, this is, you know, not scary. Anyway, I've really liked that about how he teaches us, because, you know, it's like not like the right answer. It just happens to be a good way that he's been playing with it comfortably. And he's like, it's comfortable.
Yeah. And I think a lot of the times in deep learning, it's not always intuitive why something works. So even, a lot of the time, the researchers just try out different things and different hacks, and something happens to work, and then they just publish it. They may not even have an intuitive explanation for why something works. I think even the, that happens. I think that happens quite a lot often. Yep.
Yeah. And my notebooks tend to look a little different, because what will happen is I'll get to this stage and then I start arguing with myself inside the notebook. I write down, what don't I understand, or why is this confusing me? And I just get really honest with myself and leave a note so that, you know, when I get some rest and I come back to it, like, oh, now I understand what that was doing, or whatever. Because I think it's common that we don't fully understand it. We play with things. And then we say, okay, that's kind of as good as I can get. Or maybe that's when we take it to a colleague and say, hey, can you help me see this a little bit differently? And then, you know, you kind of talk about it a little bit and try to get that intuitive grasp that is sometimes hard to get.
Yeah.
Or at least that's what I do. I tend to bump up against my what I don't understand often. And so I'll just write down in my notebooks exactly what I'm thinking, or I'll literally argue with myself in text. Okay, I think this and this. No, it can't be that because of this. And then it helps me understand it through language.
Yeah, if you learn or come across something interesting, please share with us as well. Yeah. Yeah, anything anyone have, I mean, anyone else have anything to share right now? And I think it's important to even tinker with this and see if something else helps us in improving the accuracy. Yeah, since that's how most people tend to work, I guess. Yep. Anyone else have any questions, or else we can end this session right now? I think someone wanted to share something prior to this. Okay, if no one else have any questions, we can end this session right now.
I have a thing, like, is it possible to share a GitHub link of the notebooks you have modified?
Sure. I don't think I have modified anything too much. Yeah, I can do that, but I don't think it's that. Yeah, I'll share. I'll post a link on Slack once I have uploaded it to GitHub. Sure.